Good morning, everybody. I'll do a quick introduction. So for those that don't know me, my name is Shannon. I'm an educator with Richmond Hill Fire and Emergency Services and the somewhat newly appointed president of the Ontario Association of Fire Educators. So thanks everybody for coming and thanks to Matt for being here. I'm going to turn it over to Jillian now to do a little bit of housekeeping.
Yes, good morning, everyone, and thank you, Shannon. So for people that don't know me, I'm Jillian Boyd, and I'm the Vice President for the Ontario Association of Fire Educators, and I'm from the Town of Caledon Fire Service. So as always, we have some housekeeping rules at the beginning. So if you can unmute only when you need to speak. If you have a question, if we're asked for questions, we can unmute and ask for questions. Failing that, we also have the chat where you can put any type of messaging or any announcements or any questions to our speaker in the chat. As always, we have Shannon, who is our technical expert. So we've so far had no major sort of technical difficulties, but if there are any technical difficulties, please be patient with us because we don't have any official IT person supporting us. And as Kevin always said, as we do in public education, we help each other. So hopefully we won't have any technical issues. So with that being said, you will see a first page on the Ben's Blue Bag Autism Awareness Program. And it's my delight, pleasure to introduce Lieutenant Matthew Kodicek. And Lieutenant is from the City of Crown Point Fire and Rescue Services in Indiana. And he's going to walk us through a 90-minute presentation that I know for sure we will all be able to implement and make us more confident in serving our community if we come across autism folks who are on the spectrum. So Matthew, if you're ready to start your presentation, the floor is all yours.
Thank you. First off, I just want to say thank you to everyone for joining us on the Zoom call. As of today, doing this presentation, you guys make this program international now because this is the first time I've ever done it technically out of the States. So you guys are the first to make this, I can say this program's international now that now I'm partnering with my folks up north, you guys in Canada. So first off, I would say thank you for that. This program I started about 2.5 years ago. It was more out of a necessity than anything. I saw the need for better autism training at my fire department. And from there, it's just kind of, I like to say it's like a snowball on top of the mountain where it just kind of, I just continue to get gain, you know, it just gets bigger and bigger. And hopefully after this, you know, if you guys have any questions, if you actually want a Ben's Blue Bag, we can look about send them out to you, or I can show you, I can share what we put in the bags, and it's up to you guys if you want to do, you know, do your own bags. I would say it's more like a 70-30. Most of the time the departments see what we do with our bags and how we put together and kind of trademarked or done this stuff that they would just rather, again, I was telling everyone the bags are $100 plus whatever it costs for shipping. So I haven't found too many a ton of departments that wanted to like create their own stuff. They usually like, hey, we'd rather just donate to the program and help it spread. So my information is at the bottom. If you guys need it, even afterwards, I can give it to you again. All right. So today's objectives, what we're going to talk about is introductions. We're going to review the definition of disorder. We're going over population statistics. I did find some Canadian statistics yesterday, so I've added a slide about that. Pretty proud I was able to find some stuff to add. So, you know, kind of see what you, how your guys' statistics compared to the U.S. is. How to interact with somebody that's on the autism spectrum, discuss real life scenarios. I was talking about calls that maybe you guys have had that have gone well, that's worked, and then maybe, and then, you know, I have some examples of what works with us. The Ben's Blue Bag Initiative, what you know, the actual in the bag and, you know, the concept of that. Evaluates first responders, how well we're managing patients with ASD. And then I'm not going to do the test today with you guys, but I can send the example of the test out so you guys can kind of see. I can send it out to Gillian, and then it's just on a Word document that you can give out to your personnel with an answer sheet, and you guys can grade it and see how well they paid attention. So this is my son, Ben. This is my why. This is my inspiration. Like I always tell people, Ben's fun loving. He's 8 years old now. He loves to play, learn about trains. He enjoys math. He's kind hearted. And no matter what kind of day Ben is having, he always knows how to stay positive. He really does. And like I tell everyone, if you see the different pictures of Ben growing up, the one thing about with the autism is if you look at Ben here, he looks like a normal 8-year old boy. It's not something physically you can see that, you know, the abnormalities with it being neurological. But if you spend a little time with us, you would pick up on Ben's mannerisms pretty quickly. So who am I? A little quick one on my background. I always tell people I'm Ben's dad first. Being a good dad is very important to me. I have two boys. Brayden is my youngest. He's 5. And then Ben is my 8-year-old. I'm a lieutenant on the fire department. I've been in the fire service for over 21 years. I'm on my 13th year in my career department. I'm a fire instructor. I'm an EMS educator. This past year, I started getting tasked with being a lead paramedic instructor for our accredited paramedic program. And just a background, Sean, I've been in the fire service for a little while, but I always tell people I'm not full of crap. It's not my first day. So our mission statement for Ben's Blue Bags, it's about educating and supporting first responders with these bags containing sensory stimulation items that hopefully will help you de-escalate an autistic or special needs patient during an overstimulation and emergency situation. Our values of this program, it's about recognizing, it's about educating, and it's about advocating. And then my vision, you know, for this program is to, and you know, provide this training anywhere in the country, and then having a train the trainer program going into 23, where again I can share this program out, find like-minded people who want to continue to share this kind of vision and help train first responders all over the country and US and Canada. So what is autism? So it's a neurological disorder, it's an umbrella disorder, it's spectrum, and it's lifelong. When I mean it's a neurological disorder, there's no known cure for autism. Genetics can be in the DNA of the parent, and vaccinations like Thimerosal are not the cause. So I talk about genetics being in the DNA and the vaccinations. If you look up CDC in all the stuff about vaccinations, I'm not talking about anything with COVID-19, what we've been dealing with for the last year and a half, 2 years. I'm talking about where people don't want to get like MMR or any kind of like measles, mumps, any kind of like regular child vaccinations, because they're worried that that's going to cause autism in their child. All the research has proven that that's not true. So people should not be afraid of having the normal, you know, vaccination stuff. When I talk about being genetics, can be in the DNA of the parent. A lot of times the traits and some of that stuff could be passed down genetically from parent, you know, from parent, grandparent. Like I always tell people, like, you know, my wife is more of the introvert. She's highly intelligent, very smart, but she's more on the quiet side. Her dad and her grandfather, like, were more introverted, more quiet. But her grandfather, highly intelligent on my wife's side. He actually was an inventor, created different stuff, very entrepreneur. And, you know, some of those traits can sometimes be passed down. When I talk about it being an umbrella disorder, it could fall under many different names that weren't always associated together with autism. So it could fall under autism. It could fall under pervasive development disorder. Asperger's are not otherwise specified pervasive development disorder. And a lot of times this last one I always talk about is if a child has a learning disability, but they can't really lump it into something, it's still kind of falling under the autism umbrella. And one thing I was telling everyone at the bottom is if you ever met one person with autism, you've only met one person with autism. everybody on the spectrum is going to be slightly different. What affects them, what overstimulates them is going to be slightly different. They're probably going to all have some kind of overstimulation, but what affects them is going to be different. I always told people, like, a lot of times they talk about lights and sirens affecting kids or adults and stuff like that. Ben's not affected by lights and sirens. Maybe because I dragged him with enough parades as a kid, as being a firefighter myself, it doesn't bother him. But what stuff he doesn't like is the happy birthday song. He hates the happy birthday song. Like, it didn't matter if it was my birthday or his birthday or anyone's, he hates the happy birthday song. Something about that, just, he doesn't like it. He covers his ears and wants to hide. So again, everyone is slightly different. Different levels. One thing I didn't really understand until having Ben is that there's different levels of autism. So level 3, I always tell people, when you go on those runs, you can see that those kids or adults tend to be in a group home. They need a lot of support. You can see those when you go on EMS runs. Those are easy to pick up. The level 2 and the level 1s, those are a little more difficult. Those, you're gonna have to spend a little bit of time, kind of casual observe, and hopefully you'll start picking up that. And then the level 1s, those are the ones that are out there. Any level 2 and the level 1s, I was talking about, those are the kids that are out there that are driving these days. Those are the kids that are in your honors classes. These are the people that are developing your new iPhones and Androids and your Elon Musks and stuff like that. They're highly intelligent, and with most of the time, unless they have something that overstimulates them, they're going to be pretty productive members of society. But if something overstimulates them, or they might start having a hard time, they might revert back down a level. When I talk about being on a spectrum disorder, there's different, everyone falls different on the spectrum. Subjects could be high, patients could be highly gifted, highly intelligent, again, honors classes, doctors, scientists, or their measure IQ could be very severe, where they need kind of constant assistance or somebody to stay with them. Social interaction could be active but odd or aloof. I worked with a paramedic, firefighter Jason. I always tell people, Jason was one of the best paramedics I ever worked with, but to have station life with him was pretty hard. So does anyone, like, in your firehouses, do you guys ever get together and have meals on shift?
Yeah, I think it's pretty common for our firefighters to do that.
Mm-hmm. So in our firehouse, we always get together and have dinner, right? And then whoever cooks, we would all just kind of say, hey, dinner's this much, right? Dinner's $5, right? So when I'd work with Jason, he was one of those that when you worked with him, we were going to have pizza for tonight, and Jason would be like, well, I'm only going to have 1.5 slices. So I know dinner's $6, but I'm only paying $2.75 because I'm only going to have 1.5 slices. Have we ever worked with people that are like that?
I'm sure most of us have come across. I see some thumbs up in the chat. Yeah. Yes.
So we all, but again, like, with working every third day, it was every shift it was like this. It was just, he had to, it had to be a black and white. He's only going to eat this much. So again, it started making station life kind of difficult. Now, one day Jason just kind of up and he left us. He said, hey, I'm going to go to, he worked out as pilot, and he decided he's going to be a commercial airline pilot. He's doing really good as a commercial airline pilot. Like I say, he spent about 12 years with us. But now he's off flying airplanes and loving it. But again, Jason was one of those firefighters that I worked with. Whatever he was into, he would take it to a mastery level. So off shift, if he was into mountain biking, he'd buy the best mountain bike, the best equipment, and he would do mountain biking for a year. And then once he kind of mastered that, he'd go buy something else. And then it'd be photography, or it'd be in a jeeping or something. He just, whatever he got into, he would take it to a mastery level. And once he kind of mastered it,
fire service.
What? I'm sorry, what was that?
Sorry, Matthew. Sorry for the interruption. Someone just had their unmuted their mic.
No problem. I just want to make sure if anyone had any interjection. So, like I said, he was one of those firefighters I worked with. The guys kind of, said, they always thought he might have Asperger's. But again, he was a great firefighter and he's doing really good as a commercial airline pilot. So the communication, nonverbal, earliest signs we noticed with Ben was around age three that he was nonverbal. You know, he could communicate, he could tell you, you know, he could point at a refrigerator and like, you know, open the door and be like, hey, when, you know, red yogurt versus say blue yogurt, we just could not get the words out. And a lot of times with that nonverbal, we tend to, you know, they tend to get frustrated due to not be able to communicate. On the verbal side, now, like he has, I was telling people he's got no social filter. Like he just says whatever and doesn't ever stop talking. You know, like, so on the verbal side, he will, if he wants something, he will pester you and bug you till you get it. So I always tell people like Wednesdays, like we'll go to the Dunkin' Donuts, you know, grab a coffee and a donut. So every Wednesday he'll wake up and be like, Dad, is it donut day? Dad's donut day, right? Dad, like he will bug you until you go and pick up that donut. And if I drive by a Dunkin' Donuts or something like that, if I don't stop, he'll be on me that I didn't stop that day. Like whenever they get focused on something, they will not stop talking. Motor skills, again, they could be very agile, highly athletic, Olympic. I seen there's a article not too long ago that talks about a young man. He is the first D1 full ride basketball player that's on the autism spectrum. And then again, their motor skills could be very awkward, where they need constant assistance and working on their occupational therapy. Same thing with their motor skills, highly coordinated. If you look at them with Rubik's cubes, gaming, stuff like that, their hand-eye coordination is off the charts. And then or it could fall on the other side where it's very severe and uncoordinated and they need that assistance. And then dealing with sensory, should we be more concerned with hypersensitive patients or hyposensitive patients initially when we're going on runs? What do you guys think? Hyper. Very good. So with our hyper, again, we don't know if any kind of physical touch or initial like contact with them is going to cause a fight or flight response. So we want to treat them as hyper initially until we can kind of rule that out. So when I talk about, talking about being lifelong, I always tell people with autism do not outgrow autism. But with things like speech therapy, OT, occupational therapy, and even applied behavioral analysis therapies called ABA therapies, they can better learn how to cope and improve their behaviors. So in the US, estimated lifelong cost is around $60,000 a year. So pretty expensive if you think about it, right? Like that's, you know, again, having good quality insurance and, you know, to cover some of that stuff. One thing I found is, you know, some parents where they want to get their child the therapies and the health insurance and stuff like that won't cover it. And it's really disheartening because these, you know, I would say with Ben, I wanted, you know, get him the best therapies, you know, set him up, whatever, you know, it took for him to be a very productive person in society. So it sucks as, you know, sometimes that, you know, insurance companies won't cover some of their therapies or they kind of give a run around when parents are trying to do the right thing. So U.S. statistics, if you guys look back in 2004, they were talking about 166 up to the 2018 study, which is even outdated now. We're talking about 1 in 59. And this is from my state. This is the state of Indiana. It talks about 14.65 per 1,000 students have ASD, and it's reported in all racial, ethnic, and socioeconomic groups. So this is our U.S. This is what we have for U.S. This is what I found for Canada as of yesterday. This is your guys' statistics. So some of the bullet points, males are still 1 in 42, females 1 in 65. And then for you guys, you had 56% diagnosed by age of 6 and 90% diagnosed by the age of 12. If you guys look, your stats and our stats are pretty similar. Boys are 4 times more likely than females. U.S. is exactly the same. And, you know, I think you guys are, your guys' breakdown of being able to knowing when people are diagnosed between that 6 and 12, you guys are doing even better with your stats. But again, with the cases, with you guys, you know, with 1 in 42 or, you know, or estimate 166, is your chances of having an encounter with somebody on the spectrum greater than you probably ever noticed before? Yeah, you know, for sure. So, you know, us being better trained and better understanding is definitely needed. So some early signs to look for. First off, spinning of objects. They love spinning of objects, train wheels, fidget spinners, gears, anything that goes around that they really like spinning of objects. That delay of speech, again, it was around age 3 where I noticed with Ben that we had that delay of speech where he just could not communicate what he wanted with us. And started getting, you know, frustrated, and we got him into speech therapy. Excuse me. Rejection of cuddles with that hypersensitivity side. You know, we've never had that. Ben likes deep pressure. Like, he likes big squeezes, big hugs. But can you imagine as a parent how hard that is, or a grandparent, that, like, you know, you can't give them, they don't like any kind of hug or physical contact. That's going to kind of weigh on that child parent relationship. Sleep problems. Ben is up every morning between 4:30 and 5. Doesn't matter if he goes to bed at 7 o'clock, 8 o'clock, you know, 9, he's up between every morning between 4:30 and 5. So can you guys guess who's up every morning between 4:30 and 5?
Guessing dad is.
I would tell everyone my wife. So, because I have to be up for work. But most time it's my wife, but a lot of times he's waking all I'm up to with him. Again, like, so imagine, like, you know, you have a 5-year-old that likes to go to bed like 9 or 10, and then you have, you know, but he wants to sleep in. Then you have an 8-year-old that, you know, wants to be up at 8, or, you know, wants to be up at 4:35, which at 8 years old, I feel safer if he's up and he's playing and stuff like that. But when he was 2 or 3 years old, do you want a 2 or 3 year old running your house at 4:30 in the morning? Probably not, right? So, you know, a lot of times that the parents are exhausted, you know, they're just that lack of sleep, because they don't need much. They don't need much sleep at all. And they have a ton of energy. So that kind of segues into hyperactivity. You know, like I always tell people, Ben goes hard or goes home. They're going to have a lot of energy, you know, even in the morning, like we started kind of going for walks with Ben, around the block or a little bit, just to wear off some energy prior to starting school for the day. Just because they tend to have a ton of energy. And then preference to play alone. Do you guys think that affects Ben more, or you think that affects me more as a dad? Sorry. What do you guys think? So affects me. Yeah. So it definitely affected me, you and his brother. Yeah. You know, it does at times, you know, brain gets frustrated, but like I always tell people, like, it's not that Ben dislikes people or anything like that, but he marched to the beat to his own drum. So if the kids are playing in my back, you know, I have a shared background. My neighbor, he's a fellow firefighter paramedic. He's got 3 boys. I have 2. If the kids are all playing, doing one thing, you know, Ben will be off doing his own thing, like playing with his trains. And then say he does go want to play on the playground, play on the slide. They're always off kind of doing something else. So a lot of times when I first didn't really understand why, it kind of bothered me. But the more I start to understand is they do their own thing. They don't really get caught up on what the in crowd or what everyone's doing. They kind of do their own thing. So, you know, as an employer and as bosses, you know, a lot of times these tech companies, they like to hire people like that because they can stay mission focused on whatever they want, that whatever they're into, and they don't get caught up on looking at their social media or worrying about what's going on in the water cooler. Whatever their task is, if as long as they're into it, they will stay mission focused with that. So some additional traits, resistance to change. A lot of times they like their schedule. They have their kind of, you know, set ways. And a lot of times I'll have a harder time when there's a resistance to change. That repetitive use or language of motor mannerisms. Again, some of that stuff might look foreign to us, but for them, it's kind of a coping in a way to keep calm. And then, you know, the other thing we talk about is a lot of that, they call like scripting. So Ben will do a lot of scripting where it's not just gibberish or you think it's imaginary play, but a lot of times it's repeating or reciting like shows that he likes. So if it's Thomas the Train stuff, he might, whatever, he'll tell you, he'll be like describing that show to you. The other thing is they will memorize it. Like he's memorized like the Cars movies. He can tell you every line in the Cars movies before they even happen. Whatever they get into, they will watch it over and over again and memorize it. That little or no eye contact, you got to get in their eye, you got to get in their peripherals, make sure they see you. If you're off to the side, you know, I always tell people like, well, I tell Ben to put shoes on. I'm like, Ben, put your shoes on. I got to make sure he sees me. Cause if not, like they'll be distracted. Again, that lack of interest in peer relationships. It's not that they dislike people. They kind of do their own, thing. As slow as he gets older, he's been, you know, adapting at 8 years old that he does like to invite people or want to hang out with people. He's slowly getting there. But even then, just trying to get his brother, who's five, try to get him to play with him at times, it's sometimes a struggle. And then Braden, who's five, gets, you know, frustrated because Ben doesn't want to do the same thing as him. Again, that lack of spontaneous play, make believe, like I said, they do a lot of scripting. It's called, a lot of times reciting movies and shows that they're really into. They will play it out and do that. They won't make up stuff off the top of their head, but they'll, whatever they're into, they will recite it to you. Again, and then the excessive tantrums, what you have to weigh out is what's excessive for that age group and what is it, you know, what they're being excessive over. So one thing I was told is Ben, if there's a certain direction of like, hey, which way we took home from school, if I took a different way, Ben would be upset that I didn't take a certain way because like there were some hills that he liked to go up and down. You know what I mean? He, even at like age 3 or 4, he was set on which way we took home from like the local Costco. If we didn't jump back on the highway at like 4 or 5 years old, he knew like, oh yeah, let's get on the highway because he liked to get on the clover leaf and get up to speed. That's why I was, what I talk about being excessive is like, he would like be mad at me. And like, he'd like argue with you until we got home that we took a different route. So that was, I was kind of took me as at 4 or 5 years old. He knew what route we took home from the local Costco. So here's a little quick video about autism. So I'm going to play this.
We are all different, and that's wonderful. Some differences are easy to see. Height, hairstyle, gender, eye color, and so on. Other differences can't be seen. Our favorite foods, fear, or special skills. Interestingly, the way we see the world is also different. For instance, what do you see in this drawing? Most people see a duck, but some of you might have seen a rabbit. Whichever you saw, you are correct. This is just a trick drawing to show you that all brains work differently. The brain is your body's computer. It works differently for all of us and controls how you learn. That's why we are all good at different things. How you feel, which is why we all feel different emotions. And how you communicate. Sometimes the brain is connected in such a way it affects senses and how we perceive and read situations and interactions. This is known as autism. Many people have autism, so it's likely you already know someone who is autistic. And for this reason, it's useful to know a little bit about autism. The special wiring inside an autistic brain can sometimes make the person good at tasks we may find difficult, such as mathematics, drawing, or music. It can also do the opposite, and activities we find too easy are incredibly difficult to them, such as making friends. The senses constantly send information to your brain about your surroundings and other people. However, when a person's brain and its senses don't communicate well, the brain can become overwhelmed and confused, affecting how they see the world. Picture yourself walking down the street. This is how an autistic brain may experience the same world. Scary, isn't it? Sadly, in many cases, the person can't say out loud how they feel. So even though there's chaos going on in their heads, they seem okay on the outside, unable to ask for help. We will develop behaviors to help us feel calm in uncomfortable situations. We may look away, hug ourselves, chew our fingernails, fidget, bite our lips, and so on. Equally, autistic people develop behaviors that help them cope with these intense moments. These actions may seem unusual, but they're just their way to feel calm. When they happen, it means they are having a hard time. The kind thing to do is not to give them an even harder time by getting cross, ignoring them, or mocking them. People with autism need friends who are willing to take the time to know them. With good communication and plenty of patience, everyone would be better off. People with autism are not ill or broken. They simply have a unique view of the world. And with a little support from their friends, they might just be able to share that view with us. Autism can make amazing things happen.
All right. So has anyone ever seen that video before, or is that your guys' first time seeing it? So pretty good video. Like I said, I found that kind of a good breakdown of, you know, how people on the spectrum kind of see the world and stuff like that. Give you that feeling. So how do we deal with these things? How do we deal with, how do we deal with triggers? How do we deal with stimming, meltdowns, not recognizing danger, and unintentional personal injury? So example of triggers here.
I did my best to sandproof the digs. For example, I put a cover on that mattress so it doesn't make sound in the night. And I borrowed that fancy smell maker from my roommate.
Your mom?
My roommate, to make the room smell nice. I figured you'd like eucalyptus.
Like koalas, yes.
Yeah. Last but not least, lighting. Feel the bromance. My roommate sold my lava lamp on Craigslist, so this will have to do.
All right. So did you guys see all the triggers, the white noise triggers in that case? I was asked all my like firefighters when go out doing this class in person is I go, who here deals with people snoring at the fire station? And, you know, between either like, you know, at my firehouse, we have a big bunk room. Still, there's 12 of us that sleep upstairs, and then we have our battalion chief gets to sleep downstairs. But who deals with snoring at the fire station or even in the recliners after lunch? And most of the time when you look around the crowd, they all kind of start pointing to each other. They know who the snoring is, or again, even at home, you might be the one who keeps, we all do, but I had snoring as well. Yeah. Again, like a lot of times it's a lot of pointing at each other of, you know, they know exactly, you know, who it is.
Location of Cambridge Auto Records. I will be monitoring Cambridge
as I support. So, but yeah. So what you guys saw is you saw those white noise triggers, like, you know, it just kind of compounded. It was, again, you know, it was the TV on, it was the, you know, all the different stuff, to the point where, you know, he walks away and he kind of wanders or lopes. So, not mean to do that. There you go. So if you, I'm gonna back up. So did you guys see the kind of tapping of the hands as he was originally, he was kind of pulling on the back of his ear. He was kind of doing smelling. He was trying to self-stimulate. He was trying to calm himself down. But again, that overstimulation got to the point where he wandered. So with that self-stimulating repetitive behavior, we shouldn't stop it unless it's increasing. Unless it's dangerous, don't stop it. As the frequency increases, a lot of times it means your anxiety is building up. And again, if you're even like, you ever sit with somebody who starts tapping their leg and it just gets kind of faster and faster, it's a big signal to calm that situation down because a meltdown could be pending. So example of some stimming here.
I'll leave that on. Sorry, Sammy. Sam? God. If a baby chick separates from its crush, it could freeze to death or be eaten by a variety of different predators.
Hey! What are you up to tonight? Gen drinking or doing drugs?
Adam Chinstrap, Emperor Gen 2.
What have you been taking? You tweaking?
Some are even kidnapped by other adult penguins.
Hey, stop! Sam, whoa, hey!
No, it's okay, he has-
I don't know who you are, but you need to step back.
You don't get it.
I said, get on the ground!
It's a scary world out there.
So, I'm gonna open the chat. So do you guys think that police officer handled that situation correctly?
No,
not at all. It's not a dig on law enforcement. Again, we go out and do this program with different law enforcement, but have we all worked with either on the police side or even on the fire side? Have we dealt with, I was to use example of chiefs that start yelling and screaming on scenes. And what happens when the chief starts yelling and screaming on scenes? Does the situation get better or worse? It gets worse, right? And we all have in our mind, you know, that officer, or whoever, that commander who starts yelling and screaming on scenes that got worse versus we all know that commander, or chief that no matter what the situation was, they stay cool, calm, and collective. Everything flows better that way. And even like, you know, I always talk about paramedics, like you can tell a new paramedic when they kind of get out on their own, when they're, you know, start, you know, kind of freaking out or stuff's not going right. And then you get that senior firefighter, that senior person that kind of pulls them to the side and goes, okay, kid, calm down. We'll work through this. Right. And we all know both sides of that. So it's not, and using atypical, I'll tell you, somebody even picked up, like, it's just a great example of, again, this is what Hollywood and kind of perceives us as first responders that, you know, we don't understand or have this lack of knowledge. And again, it's, doing training like this to pick up on that stuff that we all, you know, we handle these calls a lot better. So meltdown, again, there could be a fight or flight response. It could be due to overstimulation. It could be aggressive or tantrum-like behavior, or could this shut down and almost become catatonic? What we don't know is that unless it's a patient that we deal with all the time, a lot of times if it's our first encounter, we don't know what's going to happen. So the last thing we want to do is escalate and start yelling and making the situation more chaotic. It could cause injury to themselves or others, you know, and protecting ourselves and others is vitally important, and then just calming that situation down. So I always said, like, as EMS responders and firefighters, the last thing we want to do is ever have to wrestle with a patient, because there's always a chance that we're going to get hurt, the patient can get hurt, and if we get hurt, then that's a lost work. You know, we're all, you know, a lot of times it could be off work, and that's the last thing we want to do with not having enough, at least by me not having enough people to even work or want to work these days, the last thing I want to do is have anyone get hurt when it's not necessary. So an example of overstimulation?
Where legend has it, he was eaten by a ferocious lion.
Okay, everyone. Settle. It's time for a group assignment. You should all form groups of four. Quietly.
I know there aren't many lions in Connecticut. There are only four, actually.
Man, you need to get into a group.
So the chances of being eaten by one are quite small.
Man, keep up your headphones.
But we do have bears and bullies and other scary things. Suddenly, I feel like the boy in that treacherous jungle.
Hey.
Hey.
So, did you guys see the overstimulation in this one? Mm-hmm. Do you see as a teacher walks up, you know, the kids start moving the desk around and stuff like that, and you can see his eyes get really big, right? So you see his eyes get big, he puts on the headphones, right? And it's not to listen to music, but just to kind of cancel out that white noise. And what's the teacher walk up and do?
Takes away that the mic or the headset from him.
Right. So it takes him. Yeah. So does that cause that fight or flight response then?
For sure.
Yeah, yeah. So you see his eyes get really big. It causes that fight or flight response. So from there, Sam takes off and kind of goes busting out the classroom, right? And he's walking down the hallway. So his friend's like, hey, Sam, does he even pay attention to that? Does he even register at all? Nope. Right. So then from there, he walks out. He, you know, goes kind of busting out the doors, walks out and, you know, in the parking lot. And then what happens? So gets hit by the car, right? So is this all real calls that we can have in any one of our jurisdictions? Them not paying attention, just, you know, walking out, not looking both ways because they're so mission focused. Yeah, for sure. Right. So then from there, he gets up. Does he even pay attention if he's hurt or anything like that? He could have a broken leg and he would have dragged that broken leg. Yeah, not at all. Like he would continue. So he continues on into the art room, right? So even then, if you guys notice, when he goes in the art room, does he sit down in an empty classroom? He goes into a closet. He sits down. He's in kind of a tight cubby hole area, you know, kind of closed off, and then looks up and doesn't even recognize that there's a girl right across from him smoking some kind of medical marijuana, right? And I was, you know, everyone kind of chuckles about it. And I was, you know, joking, says take anybody back to their high school days. And so some people kind of put their heads down and hide. And I'm like, listen, I'm not here to judge anyone. Whatever you guys did in your high school days is fine. So again, it shows it, you know, it's from a show, but it's all real calls that we could get called upon. So what do you need to know? So one thing I always talk about, I got this from a fellow firefighter instructor, who was one of the authors for our fire instructor one book from IFSTA. And think about this, what do you need to know? So whenever you do a training, do you hit one of these four things? So better. So the better understanding, are we going to make for a better call or better rescue if we know what's going on ahead of time compared to when we go on a unknown medical? Does that make a difference? You know, getting our mindset of, you know, we know how to handle these calls. Yes. Right. the faster we recognize and understand the situation, the quicker we can bring it under control. So let's talk about firefighters. The faster we get to the scene of fire and knock out, you know, the main body of the fire, does everything start to get better? Would you guys all agree?
Yes, totally agree. Yeah.
Right. And then improved awareness. So I would ask improved awareness, patient outcomes, BLS versus ALS. So I would ask my paramedics, I go, what, you know, paramedics, what would you guys rather have to do? Where you have to start an IV, put them on the cardiac monitor, give them sedation, or BLS and the EMT takes it? And what do you think my paramedics told me?
I would guess the BLS.
Basically, I support paramedics like, heck yeah, we need to drive to the hospital, right? And then I'll ask my EMTs, I'll said, EMTs, what would you guys rather do? Basic, you know, BLS where you have to transport the patient to the local hospital, or fire gets on scene or PD gets on scene, they calm the situation down and they say no patient contact and you can go back in service. And what do you think my EMTs told me?
That last one, no transport.
No transport, and we don't have to write a report, right? No contact.
That's right.
Yeah, so everyone, you know, is kind of passing down. And then using smart technology like Benzobag hopefully will benefit all that are involved. So some dangerous situations. Drowning is a leading cause of death in children with autism. 90% of the deaths occur under the age of 14. And the reason why with this is that number of stimuli associated with water, it hits all their senses. It's the feel of the water, it's the sounds, it's the waves and the splashes, and even the visual light reflecting off and smell can even be enticing. And the more I did this project and been going with Ben through bags, you know, the more I thought about it is, are we not all somewhat attracted to water? So I always ask people, Where do people go like in the wintertime for like spring break? Where do most people want to travel to?
A hot destination where there's an ocean, a sea.
Right. The pool. Beaches, right? Beach. You know, they talk about going to the beaches, South Beach, warmer weather, right? So, you know, the difference is that, you know, everyone kind of, you know, and they talk about, you know, if you always want to retire to the warm weather, you know, the beaches or, you know, in vacation, the Caribbean, you know, and stuff like that. So I feel like we're all somewhat attracted to that water. But the difference is that we can decipher between warm water and cold water and deep water, where their attraction is so great that like it doesn't matter. They don't care what it is that they're attracted to that water. So what's another special group of people that we get called upon sometimes that are also down the spectrum, but there's another special needs group of people that also seem to be attracted to water? So Alzheimer's dementia patients also? Right? And then, so I was talking about, what do they tend to build around every nursing home to kind of go along with that? A pond, exactly. And I kind of laugh, I go, and so I was laughing, I go, you know, so I have, you know, we have a bunch of nursing homes in our town or city. I go, and there's a pond around, you know, around every one, you know, I'm like, it's almost setting up for, you know, disaster. You know what I mean? You have the memory care unit right now you have a pond right next to it, you know, and just hope that nobody gets out. So I'm going to play this one.
I mean, we were just having Christmas. The kids were playing.
But Brittany Knapp says they did not see little five-year-old Bo Belson. They started looking for him, but did not find him. So they called police. Within hours, an all-hands-on-deck search started within the small town of Six Lakes. Police searched from the air, while neighbors walked miles and miles deep into the woods looking for little Bo. I've
seen how many people walk hand-in-hand combing through, trying to find him. Means a lot.
24 hours gone and still nothing. Thursday afternoon, they heard the dreadful news.
The body of five-year-old Bo Belson was located shortly after noon today by our Michigan State Police Marine Services team in a body of water just adjacent to his residence under the ice, and unfortunately he was found deceased.
So again, if you guys look up, there just recently went out in, I want to say it's Oklahoma. It was a little five-year-old boy. They have him on security footage. He got out of the parents' apartment, and he goes and walks right into, you guys had one there as well, Corey. Yeah, the one on Oklahoma, they had the video on the security footage of the child walking right into the pool. Like, I mean, he just steps right down the deep end and starts drowning. Fortunately, in that case, a little 12-year-old boy grabbed his dad, saw it, and the neighbor dad jumps in and end up saving the child. But again, like it, you know, and even since I've done this program, I've had numerous different locations who've reported back to me that we've had incidences very similar. A couple counties away, I was doing a city department over there. They a month after I left them, they had an incident. You know what I mean? It was a local pond at an apartment complex. So again, like it could happen in your jurisdiction at any time. So fire, people with on the autism spectrum will continue to resist or restraint during a fire emergency. So firefighters must stay with that person or hand them off to another caregiver because they may try to run back inside. You know, adults with autism are just like as likely to hide in a fire situation. So checks, you know, make sure we're doing in closets, tight spaces, under beds, behind furniture during our search and rescue.
Alex was the first one to smell the smoke and he woke me up. We were headed out the door. I realized that time he wasn't there. By the time I got back up on the porch, the fire had engulfed the living room. I ran around the side of the house.
Joseph Swigert says in the confusion, he realized his autistic son, Alex, was not by his side. Firefighters had to stop Dad physically from going back inside the burning home. Once the fire was extinguished, firefighters made the heartbreaking discovery. 12-year-old Alex had been huddled near his dad's bed.
I yelled inside the window. I yelled inside the window, and I heard him inside say, "Daddy, I can't breathe." They started a little memorial. "Alex, you know, we love you. We miss you. You're one of our best friends."
So again, this was a trailer fire out in Arizona. And like I said, I've been in the fire service since I was 19 years old. I'm a third generation. My dad was a volunteer fireman. My grandfather was a volunteer fireman. You know, everything growing up, you know, again, you guys are big on fire prevention. This group, you know, we do a lot of close the door, close before you doze and all that. You know, we teach kids get low and go, stay, you know, get out, stay out. So it's really hard to imagine that a person would run back in, but again, they're going to go back to where they feel safe. In this case, it was next to his dad's bed. Again, trailer fire went up very quickly. Just kind of heartbreaking. And this is just one of different many instances. Again, you can find on, you know, just searching on YouTube and stuff like that. So, you know, again, if that means us, like I always tell people, if that means us taking a firefighter play or putting them in the back of a chief's car or in the back of the fire engine or, you know, one of the five police cars that are parked in front of your fire hydrant on scene, the last thing we're going to do is let them out of our sight because they may try to go back inside. Wandering. 49% of children with ASD have that tendency to wander or bolt from a safe setting. And again, individuals with ASD have little or no sense of danger. And they have a greater chance of being hit by a vehicle, and supervision is key.
This hit and run happened around 7 p.m. Friday night near Deerfield Road and Beverly Place. The driver going westbound on Deerfield. Thad Thompson says his son, who is autistic and nonverbal, left the family's home without their knowledge and ran into the street when he was hit. Thompson says a neighbor's security camera showed the driver hit the brakes and then keep going.
So again, with that wandering, you know, well, one thing I can tell you as I learned more about that with kids wandering or bolting, they're not going to just, like, it's almost a bad calling it wandering, but they have a mission. I was told, like, there's a mission, like they're going to want to either when they go out, they're going to their mission might be going to water, you know, because they're really attracted to water. It might be to the gas station or certain, you know, certain stuff, but a lot of times they don't just wander around. They have a mission of where they're trying to go to. So think about that when you're doing your searches. If somebody, you know, that's a little bit I've been learning more about dealing, talking about with missing person search stuff is these kids, just like Alzheimer's patients, they tend to have a mission on where they want to go to. It's not, they're just not going to walk around. They have a point. They have something in mind that they're trying to go to. So next, one examples we use out in our area is Project Lifesaver. It's a program that started out on the East Coast of the U.S. If you guys aren't familiar with Project Lifesaver, it just one of there's a couple different different programs. It's one that we use. It's a really cool system. The neat part about it is if you see down here, all the clients have more of a band and it's a radio transmitter. So the difference between that and say like a RFID tag or something like that is that's awesome. Yeah, it's a Project Lifesaver. I would say the great part about that program is that they're kind of banded like a hospital band. So the problem with when you have something that's tied to like a piece of clothing, like on their shoes, is a lot of times they might wander or go out without shoes on. Having it where it's actually kind of tied to their wrist or tied to their ankle, they're less likely to get it off. So, and if you guys have any other questions about Project Lifesaver, let me know. I see, like I said, Corey H even said that they use it. You guys have had a lot of good success with it. So unintentional injury, again, they may harm themselves. It could be from stimming, a meltdown, not recognizing danger. So making sure we still have them checked thoroughly, even if they don't have complaints. Some calming strategies, we want to stay calmer, reduce stimuli, avoid touch when possible, may need to leave the immediate area. Again, it might just mean backing out, that we don't overcrowd them too much. Turning off our lights and sirens, are your departments, are you guys good about turning off your lights and sirens? Or do we still have people coming in at, 3 o'clock in the morning with their, the cue siren blaring? Because if I'm up there, everyone's up kind of attitude. Do we all know people that are like that?
Sorry, not much of a response there. Maybe you get a better response from our suppression crews.
Right. Yeah. So, and good with sirens, but lights on. Yeah. So even, I had a case in, on a corporate area, west of me the other day, and the local sheriffs, I had, fellow like fire chiefs kind of report back, like, listen, the sheriff's guys show up and they're in a cul-de-sac and they all got their lights and sirens going. And he's like, they had to tell them, like the sheriff's, officers, like, hey guys, turn off your lights and sirens. Okay. Like if they are scared, you're going to make it worse. They thought by having the lights and sirens, they're going to get the kid to come out. But you're better off turning off your lights and sirens than to have them all going. They're not usually going to be attracted to the lights. They might more be deterred and go the other way. So take us to the actual bags. So again, here's a couple of pictures of Ben. Playing, you guys get to see, and here's a different type of bag. So the bad part about doing the presentation on Zoom is I don't have you guys in person, so you guys can get to play with the items. So that's kind of the flip side of doing this via Zoom. So here on my left is a paramedic firefighter Eric Henry, and he's a paramedic firefighter out in Ohio, and he had the idea of doing a sensory bag. And putting it on their ambulance, which kind of was my inspiration for doing this. But what we didn't have was an actual presentation, which Ben's Blue Bags kind of turned into, of why we have the stuff and what to look for and all that stuff. So that's what kind of inspired me was Eric's kind of initial idea. On the right here, you can see the article. This is from back in 2021 with one of the bags and Ben actually playing with the stuff. So what's in the bags? So if you guys see the bags here on the left, this is one of my first bags I ever did. Now I've actually updated to a bigger bag. We have our own, the Ben's Blue Bag logo that we put on every bag. And the reason why I came up with this was Ben's favorite color is blue. I wanted, being in fire and EMS for years, I wanted something when the crews, when you tell them to go get the bent through bag, it was easily identifiable. So our bags are, again, they're this, like more, the new ones are more of a dark blue, and we have the patch on, it says Benzu bags. So a lot of times, like, cause they get stuffed, you know, an ambulance in a cabinet, underneath a seat in a fire engine or something, in the back of a squad car. So again, if you send somebody, you know, if you send that rookie or that new person, go get it, you go get the Benz blue bag, that it's easily identifiable. They can find it, and they can grab it quickly. Again, like, I've just been in the fire service long enough. You know, got to make everything firefighter friendly. So the first thing on there is a dry eraser board. So we've even, like, since, you know, these are the original dry eraser boards, I worked with my local print company. They created a very thinner dry eraser board for me, where on the back it has, you guys see where it hurts. So can these boards be utilized for somebody that's just nonverbal? It doesn't have to necessarily be somebody in the spectrum. Yeah. The first time I ever actually used this was on a neighboring department just north of me. We got called to a group home, and you know, the guy, he was a 26-year-old. He was in a group home. They called us because he needed to be transported to a local hospital because he broke the iPad and supposedly broke out a window because he got upset. So I get there, and the police officers had him cuffed and standing outside the home. You know, so I go up to him, like, hey, what's going on? They're like, oh, he was having a hard time. You know, he was being aggressive. At the time, he was not being aggressive whatsoever. I had with him, but we can't communicate with him. He's nonverbal. He doesn't communicate. So I give him back in my ambulance, and I offered him a fidget spinner. I'm like, hey man, you want a fidget spinner? And he kind of shakes his head. Yeah, you know, gets excited. And then I pulled out the driver's board to go, do you want to write? And what was amazing about that is when I give him the driver's board, and I remember he took the red. He wanted the red color. He fills out all his information. It's name, date of birth, you know, past medical history, different, like, local hospital they was at, had, like, all his intake, his case managers, and all that. Is when he handed it back to me, his penmanship was off the charts. Like, he had perfect penmanship. Like, it was unbelievable. And you would never expect a 26-year-old male living in a group home who had perfect penmanship. And again, he just needed a way to communicate. You know, when I was like, hey, is your arm hurt? Yeah, points to his arm, you know, and he just needed a way to communicate. No one had tried to, you know, use that. So the great thing about the dry eraser board is, can we use it over and over again? Like, use it, you know, fill out whatever we need, clear it off, and then stays in there. It, you know, right? Makes it very resourceful. The squeeze pull feel. You know, the biggest thing with these items is letting my firefighters and my EMTs, my paramedic, my police officers, let them play with these items. All right. They're great, fun items. They start playing with the marble mesh, you start playing with the rubber worms, and they're great. Like, you know, I always tell people, like, they're like, when I first started this program, I went to my medical educator EMS director at the time, and when I was showing Rob this, I go, hey, you know, this is my idea and this stuff. And he's like, well, how do you know this is going to work? Have you beta tested it? And I told him, I said, listen, I gave it to a bunch of firefighters and they seem pretty entertained with it. So I think it'll work with kids. And he kind of, like, gave me a hard time. And then I took the bag up to him and I showed him the original stuff, and he started playing with the items, and he kind of saw, like, oh, this is cool. And it saw how they're great de-escalating items. And from there, he just kind of was like, hey, let's do all the departments that are associated with our hospital system. And from there, it just kind of kept growing. But what I needed was, I didn't have a great presentation or why, you know what I mean? And that's what Benzo bags turned into, was that is teaching you guys the why. So the problem solvers, they're great. Problem solver items work really good with, if they need a task. The Rubik's Cube works really good. The lava lamp, you can flip this little lava flippy thing, it works really good. The dots, they can count the dots, they can, you know, whatever, you know, you can think of, you can give them a task. And then same thing with the bendy bracelet, they can manipulate it, move it all around in different shape, and it gives them little stuff to work on. The earmuffs, every bag I put two sets of earmuffs in ours. Again, there's multiple times we've seen these earmuffs work out really great. I've had departments tell me they've used them on extrication calls where, you know, even if somebody who's not even on the spectrum but is having a hard time, do all the noise from on a loud extrication, they've utilized them. I've had people tell me they've been at standbys for fireworks. They've used them where the kids start having a hard time. So they could see that they saw, the child or adults having a hard time. They've offered them out and they've worked really good. So, I mean, there's such a wide variety of, sometimes people will have headphones with them. There's other times they may not. So just handing these headphones out sometimes will really help cancel that white noise. And then the fidget spinners. Every bag we do four fidget spinners in there. And again, they're great refocusing items. They've been using them in schools. And again, it just kind of calms them down. So some ABCs of autism. Awareness, basic calmness, and safety. So we want to be aware of different behaviors and be aware of changing our strategies, right? Always have a plan B and C in place. So stick to the basics, basic instructions. I always tell people basic questions, basic stuff, basic people, and basic treatment. So I ask, are we doing anything advanced level here? I mean, is this all basic stuff? We're keeping it very simple, right? There's no crazy IV medications or anything like this. It's all very basic. So what's a good basic instruction we could give them? What do you guys think? So as simple as just stop, sit, right? What's a, we don't want to give them too complex stuff, one thing at a time. So what's a basic question we could ask them?
We could ask, does it hurt or where it hurts?
What's your name? Does it hurt? I always tell people, if you ask Ben, what's your name? What's your address? He'll tell you his address. He'll tell you 10615 Illinois Street, Crown Point, Indiana, right? He'll tell you, if you ask Ben his address, he'll tell you the exact address every single time. He'll never give you half an address or half an answer. He will always give you that same address verbatim over and over again. But if you ask Ben, like, hey, do you live in that blue house down the street? He'll look at you like, blue. But if you go, what's your address? He'll tell you 10615 Illinois Street, Crown Point, Indiana. So whatever those answers, they memorize it, they will give it back to you verbatim. Basic stuff. Again, everything in the bag. Do you guys see anything with the items in the bag? Do you guys see anything that runs on batteries?
No.
Do you see anything that needs Wi-Fi or any kind of electrical connection?
No.
The reason I always push upon that is, does anyone ever give, like, anyone have young children? You let your kids have an iPad and then try to take it away after about 30 minutes. What happens?
They get very, very mad.
Right. So what I always tell people, they freak out, they get mad, is why give them electronic or something like that when you're going to have to take it away, like, eventually, like when you get to the hospital or anything like that, versus, or it has to be charged, it needs internet connection. Everything in the bags, like, are basic items, right? So whatever they find that calms them down, let them keep it, okay? There's multiple things in the bags, so you can resupply it as needed. So there's four squeeze balls. There's multiple, you can get a Rubik's Cube pretty easily replaced. It's find out whatever works for them and then let them keep that stuff. Like I always tell people, we do our charting on our iPads at work in the ambulances. So if I give the iPad over to the patient, can we do our patient charting or anything like that? No. What happens if they do get mad and they break it? Now I have to go back to my fire chief and be like, hey, chief, the iPad got broken in ambulance one. Is he going to be happy with me? Probably not. Or I always tell people, like, are you going to hand your phone over to, over to a patient that you don't know? And then what happens if it gets broke? Do you think your department is going to pay for your iPhone or something like that? Most chiefs tell me, no, you're on your own. So again, there's basic people. And again, it's basic, first responder treatment that we're providing here. So we want to stick to the basics. We want to be, We want to be calm. We want to be clear and controlled. We don't want to be aggressive in our behaviors. We want to offer empathy and compassion. We don't want to force our agenda unless it is life-threatening. So if they're going to go run back into a building that's on fire, if they're going to go into water or run out in traffic, we might need to use some restraint at that point. So we want safety. We want to remove all threats. So move them away from water, move them away from the house that's on fire, move them away from the expressway, that they might try to, run out in traffic. Begin care where they feel safe. Anticipate problem areas. So, I have a child in town that we get called to quite often. I always tell people, we know going into it, like there's always a big disconnect between the dad and the child. So what we try to do in anticipating is separating him, get him calmed down, because the dad always seems to, and it's a foster dad, but seems to like cause more strain. So we always try to, separate that. Explaining our procedures. I always tell like my EMTs, my paramedics, kind of show on your own arm or something like that before doing it. And restraint should only be last resort. So a quick repair strategy. It talks about, get your arms open, palms strapped to your side. You don't want to be like your arms crossed, or like I always pick on my law enforcement friends where they're kind of, when they have their vest and they kind of have their arms tucked, their hands kind of tucked in their vest, where it kind of looks like an aggressive stance. They will pick up on that stuff. So, we don't want to look aggressive because then they might start getting aggressive too. And then we want to be quiet and quietly reassure them. The stuff we don't want to do is discuss, make threats. If you don't do this and this, then this happens, or consequences, or extra language. And no apologizing. So what I mean by like with no apologizing is if they do need a medication or do need to do a procedure like a blood pressure, and if it gets a little tight in their arm, what we do is we don't be like, oh, sorry, I had to do that. You just go like, hey, this is, we need to do this. We need to check your vital signs, or we need to give you this medication. What we don't want to do is have them associate that any of their care that we do means that, that equals pain, because they will remember that stuff. So along with that is, if calming them down, or getting them to come out means you have to take them out and show them the ambulance or show them the fire engine, a lot of times from the fire engine prior to going, in the ambulance, you want to follow through with that. Don't promise something that you can't deliver, because they'll hold you to it. Like Ben knows, every Wednesday, we go get, a morning donut. And if it comes Wednesday, if I don't do it, he'll hold me, to it. So whatever you say you're doing, you want to make sure you follow through with it. So simple blanket rescue technique. So the idea with this, you can take your turnout coat or hospital blanket and just wrap it around them and create a protection between you and the patient, and allows you to kind of direct them and move them without touching them. So some scenarios here.
So we were called to a motor vehicle accident in our area, and we arrived on scene. We found two vehicles with minor damage. We were directed to a vehicle where we had a 30-year-old restrained female driver who had minor neck and back complaints. She pointed us to the back seat where we saw her 6-year-old son. Minor cut on the forehead, but you could tell he was immediately apprehensive to our presence. The mother advised us that her son was autistic.
All right, so now that you guys kind of seen the bags, what's something you think you could utilize in this call? What do you guys think? The where it hurts chart, good. Anyone else? What do you guys think? Where it hurts, small suspicious parents. Good. So we'll see what Dale did in this case.
So we came around to the back of the vehicle, and immediately the little boy's tension went through the roof at our presence. So I went into Ben's blue bag, and I reached in, and the first thing that I came across was the marble and mesh, which is really simple, provides some sensory stimulation and relief for the child. I handed it to him. His focus became that and not my presence, which allowed me to assess his injuries and begin some good rapport with that young man.
So again, initially he had a child, doesn't allow you to examine him. However, he had a laceration to his head. Dale, one of my coworkers, used a marble mesh as a great distractor, calm the patient down, now allows you to examine him and take care of that laceration. So next one.
We were dispatched for a 14-year-old male psych patient at the grocery store initially. Upon arrival, we found a 14-year-old boy who was sitting Indian style on the grocery floor, very overstimulated in a lot of emotional distress, per se. There's a lot going on around him, a lot of yelling, a lot of talking, a lot of bystanders.
So what do you guys think in this case? What would you guys, how would you handle this one? Possible headphones. Good.
Rather.
Yep. We also try to calm that situation down, maybe move people away. Distract first. Yeah, so we'll take a look here.
So we got the bench pool beds, and we've had them in the past before. So we kind of knew a general idea of what he liked. His personal go-to was either this little ball here. Personal favorite so far has been the fidget spinner. So he immediately took the fidget spinner and started fidgeting with that and seemed to calm him down and walked him out of the store without any issues. And
again, Kayla had an overstimulated young adult. People are at the store, they're yelling, they're overcrowding them. They reduce stimuli, limiting how many people are interacting. And then they use that fidget spinner, it seemed to work on him and no longer need any medical attention. So scenario three.
So our ambulance got dispatched to a residential address that was toned out for a male in his 30s with a possibly dislodged catheter. Upon arrival, we did find a male in his 30s. He was ambulatory, and that was the only issue going on at the time. Patient was able to sit on our cot with no issues. Once we got him outside, though, with the noise of the truck and some other outdoor sounds, we did notice that the patient was beginning to become a little agitated.
So what do you guys think of this one? Muffs. Yeah, this one. This one, again, that when they called me about this one saying, hey, we use earmuffs, I was like, what'd you guys go on? Like it didn't make sense. And then, as you guys see.
So after we got the patient in the ambulance, we did notice that he was extremely agitated at this time. There were some outdoor noises, the ambulance noise with the air conditioner. I went into the cabinet and I got Ben's blue bags out to see if there was anything in there the patient would like. No response from the patient from any of the puzzles or the Rubik's Cube or fidget spinner until I grabbed on the earmuffs. The patient saw the earmuffs and was immediately excited about it. I took them out of the plastic, put them on. He actually put them on himself. And at that time, he got completely anxiety-free, was very calm, and was perfect all the way to the hospital.
So again, they had an adult having basic medical problem that's compounded by white noise triggers. They use the headphones that calms them down, eliminates that white noise, and they transport them. They told me on this one, they're like, hey, we left the headphones with him at the hospital. They said he was calm. So the hospital is very appreciative of it. You know, a lot of times they don't have any of these things at the hospitals. So last scenario.
Okay. So while I was driving patrol, found an overturned minivan. It was gold, had a mother, and I believe it was her 4 or 5 year old daughter. Turned out to be a PI crash. So while we were out, paramedics took the mother. The daughter was completely distraught, losing it, didn't know what to do without her mother. So
again, Ashley pulls up on a motor vehicle crash by herself initially.
Okay, so obviously the little girl was very upset, agitated, didn't want to be away from her mother. So I thought, come grab my Ben's blue bag. Decided to have her come take a look at it, told her there's a lot of cool things in here, get her distracted, help build that bond with her. So then she decided to come in here once she saw we had a bunch of different items. She came in here, actually. She found these little jelly worms that we have. She actually started playing with that, which helped out a lot because it helped distract her, let her take them home. She was able to hang out with us while mom got checked out, and then paramedics transported her and mother. So,
So again, child involved, mom's hurt, unable to care for child. Officer took her due to we had limited resources at the time, which is any one of our departments, you know, any day. Use rubber worm, patient's now relaxed and didn't need any medical attention. So things that worked for you guys, anybody, stuff that's worked good for you guys on calls that you've, you know, the team that helped, anyone have anything?
So what we have on our frontline truck is we have stuffed animals. We have Sparkies, mm-hmm. little stuffed animals, teddy bears, Sparkies, so that if a child has been involved in some incident, we can give them a comfort bear to calm them down a little bit. We also have comfort blankets.
Gotcha.
We had a donation come in, and they're just little small blankets.
Yeah.
So the kids, you know, can sort of cuddle themselves and keep themselves secure and feel a little bit safer.
Gotcha. Do you guys care? Does anyone carry any kind of like sensory items like this yet in any of their departments? Or is this something maybe you guys might look into doing? Gotcha. So in scenario one, family transported one ambulance, non-life-threatening injuries to local hospital. Our two, patient calmed down, it was a no patient contact, didn't need anything. Three, transported him to ED, kept the headphones, and then four, child calmed down, child didn't need any medical attention. So questions and answers, was the presentation helpful? Did you guys get some, hopefully you guys got something out of this? Again, you guys can obviously turn your mics on if you guys, you know, anything you guys want, you know, interject or anything like that.
Yeah, I'm sure that many departments have various different tools in their toolbox, and this would be just an excellent tool in the toolbox to better serve our community. And what you've shared with us today is just a fantastic idea to make every situation, not only for the firefighters, first responders, the families, but for the child that's involved themselves. So it was excellent, and I would love to start putting the Ben's blue bags on our trucks and training our firefighters and first responders in our neighborhood so that we can implement this program immediately.
For sure.
Excellent idea.
I do all the bags myself. I can tell everyone it's a flat $100, and then everything like part of it goes back into the program to allow us to go out and do more classes in person and stuff like that. And like I said, you guys can put a sensory bag together. It's not very hard. What I like is when you call it like a Benzo bags, just putting that associated with something that the firefighters and the police officers and the paramedics, they're like, oh yeah, the Benzo bags. They know it, you know, just kind of put it with something that's associated with. But again, like I always encourage you guys, like, you know, don't be afraid to build your own bags or anything like that. There's no right or wrong, you know, with this. You know, I try to, you know, the big thing I push onto like my medical directors and stuff like that is that, you know, the idea with the sensory bags is that we're not giving it to an infant. Children are like 3 years old or a little bit older. And again, like, you know, they're like, well, what about it being a choking hazard or something like that? I go, listen, nothing like anything you give the child, you should never like let the child out of your sight. So somebody's always with them, keep an eye on them. If they do start putting something in their mouths, then you got to remove it. You know, like they can put anything in their mouths. It doesn't matter if it's a toy or not, if it's a stuffed animal. So the difference is just giving them something that kind of the kids these days, again, they work our iPhones. They know how to do this stuff. You know, their technology is so much higher than it was for, you know, us older generation, that they need something that's more stimulating. So just a list of different apartments I've been to throughout the area. Just gave a timeline of, you know, we've been to, all the way out to Virginia. I was just out in the DC area. You guys being out here covering Canada, even though it's kind of Zoom, still, you know, it's great to get out here. You know, I'll tell you, like, I was thinking doing the presentation in person is a little bit better, and when you can let the firefighters play with the stuff. But again, it's still awesome to get this out to you guys. Some famous people on the spectrum, if you didn't know, as you guys see here, actress Daryl Hannah, scientist Albert Einstein, director or actor and director Dan Aykroyd, and director Tim Burton. So just my sources, always cite different friends who've helped me along the way with this project. And when I talk about him close to home, this is an incident I had in my county last year.
The body of a missing 12-year-old boy has been found in a river.
Glenn Marshall is at the scene in Hammond with an update. Glenn?
Yeah, good morning. We just received that information from the coroner's office. This is not the outcome that anyone was hoping for in this situation, but police did say that a volunteer kayaker actually found that body about 300 feet away from the Best Western where Kyron was staying with his family. Take a look at this video from last night. The Lake County Coroner's Office was here on the scene last night, as well as police, after 12-year-old Kyron Carter was found. Around 8:15 last night, a volunteer kayaker alerted police that a body was located in the Little Calumet River near New Jersey Avenue, which is about 300 feet from the Best Western Hotel where the 12-year-old went missing. Recently, officials stopped the flow of water coming into the Little Calumet River to make it easier to continue their search. A dive team was able to remove Kyron's body from that river last night. Family identified the body with the Lake County Coroner's Office. Police say back on May 15th, the 12-year-old had went missing when he left the Best Western on 179th Street in Hammond, Indiana. Surveillance video showed the boy walking out of the hotel. Again, that body that has been found here at the Little Calumet River has been identified as 12-year-old Kyron Carter.
So again, you know, one thing I was kind of like to share with that is, you know, we have this incident. I was with this fire department about a month prior to. They're a pretty large department. They have 9 stations. I spent 3 days with them doing multiple classes, and you know, for them, when I was out there working with my water rescue team, their firefighters come up to me like, hey, like you were just talking about this whole attraction of water. And, you know, they had just a better understanding why, you know, what happened with Kyron. But again, like I said, if you guys don't think it can happen in your area, and I saw somebody said they had an incident, it can, you know, I mean, every one of our areas are susceptible to this. So that's all I have. Go ahead and stop screen scare, stop share. Again, if you guys have any questions or anything, I can hang out for a couple minutes. Thank you guys for letting me present to you guys. Hopefully, if you have any questions, again, bensbluebags@gmail.com, you can email me, you guys, and help, you know, I can direct you guys anyway with that.
Well, Matthew, on behalf of the Ontario Association of Fire Educators, thank you very, very much. And I'm sure you have inspired a lot of people to think about putting Ben's Blue Bags program into their municipal fire department. Thank you very much for the time that you spent, the information that you shared, and it was all very valuable. And thank you that you're able to see us in person or virtually, you can still see us, and that we've actually made that connection, and that if anyone's interested, they can reach out themselves to you and start, you know, the program in their neighborhood.